Thank you. All right, so this is this talk is going to be an infomercial or an advertisement or a trailer for a grammar that's being written right now, even as we speak. And it's on a Philippine language, Kagayanen, which is a core Philippine language in the sense of it has all the interesting features that Philippine languages are known to have. And you may or may not be aware that Philippine languages are famous for having a particularly unusual clause structure. People have used, oh, by the way, there's a handout, right? Has the handout gotten around? I haven't seen it, but
yes.
Yeah, okay. I've got a copy here on my computer, but I want to make sure everybody has one they can look at because the data is there. So now, those of you that are used to looking at Tibeto-Burman or Indo-Aryan languages or Turkic languages, just imagine that you're looking in a mirror when you look at Kagayanen clause structure. Okay? The case markers are not suffixal. The verb tense aspect modality markers are not, for the most part, suffixal. They're all prefixal. The case markers are prenominal. They come before the nouns. Okay, so if you see something that says ergative or absolutive or genitive or something like that, it goes with the thing to the right, not the thing to the left. Okay. But the thing about Philippine languages is that it has this wonderful way, or they have this wonderful way of organizing grammatical relations and semantic roles. And a lot of linguists, a lot of people have looked at them and come up with all kinds of interesting ways of trying to analyze Philippine languages. There's a list of possibilities there on your handout. Ever since Bloomfield, 1917, people have been struggling to figure out what's going on with Philippine languages. But I'm here today to tell you that we've figured it out. Okay. The truth is now before you. And I'm going to give you the truth. I'm not going to rehash the debate, you know, the different, you can analyze it this way, you can analyze it that way. I've done that kind of colloquium maybe once or twice before over the years here. But I'm just going to present the basic clause structure of Kagayanen. This is a chapter out of this grammar. And I hope it will encourage you all to go out and buy the book when it comes out and tell all your friends about it. Okay, so first of all, I do have a little clicker to complicate this. First of all, I just have a few things to say about Kagayanen, because it is a real language spoken by real people in a real place. I assume most of you or all of you know where the Philippines are, where the Philippines is, because that's the name of the country, is the Philippines. So the Philippines is just south of Taiwan, okay? So there's not a big map that shows you where the Philippines is, but this is where Kagayanen is spoken, right there. All right, so this is Panay, this is Palawan, and Luzon, the main island of the Philippines, is up there. Right in the middle of the Philippines, this Visayan Sea here, is a little group of seven islands where Kagayanen is spoken. And I think here's a picture of it, okay? This is the capital, and the island basically goes, well, it doesn't go over there. It's, you know, not much bigger than what you see right there. And 30,000 people live there. And mostly multilingual, they speak Kagayanen, this language that's the topic of this presentation. But they're multilingual in Filipino, Ilonggo, Cebuano, and or English, all right? Education is in English and Filipino, but there's a strong language development project going on right now in Kagayanen, and people are becoming interested in their own language, which is wonderful. So there are basically seafarers and aquaculturalists, okay? So they grow sea produce and sell it. You've probably eaten some of their produce in market of choice if you've gone there and ordered their salads. And there's just a few pictures of folks that speak this language. Okay, and that's the end of the slideshow. And now we're going to look at the handout. Okay, so here's the handout. And you've got it in front of you. And what you see on the screen is a little bit different because I've added a few things since I printed out, or somebody printed out the handout, Paul printed out the handout for me. okay, so what I'm going to try to convince you of is that Philippine languages, although they're wonderful and special and, you know, have their own magnificence to them, they can be, this basic clause structure can be described in terms that are familiar to linguistic typologists. Okay, they're not all that unique. Okay, something could be more or less unique. Philippine languages are not all that unique. Okay, and the concepts that allow you to understand how this language in particular works are the concepts of grammatical versus semantic transitivity. Okay, I'm going to make that distinction. And I'm also going to enrich the notion of voice a little bit. Okay, and this isn't my idea. These are ideas that are out there in the literature, but I thought I would just kind of present them all so that folks that may not be familiar with the literature will understand what I'm saying. Okay, so semantic transitivity, by that I mean the number of required participants in a scene. So we're talking about conceptual scenes that are expressed, that are communicated in language. We're not talking about clauses yet, okay? We're just talking about scenes, situations that folks might want to communicate with one another, okay? And different scenes, different kinds of situations require one, two, three, maybe more participants in order to qualify as that kind of scene, right? Grammatical transitivity, on the other hand, has to do with the number of core arguments in a clause. So you take a clause like, or a sentence like, I already ate, okay? You've got a semantic valence of two because you know the scene involves eating, and you don't have an event of eating unless you haven't eaten thing, right? So if you say, I already ate, you know I ate something, right? Or else I didn't eat. If there wasn't something that I ate, then it's not true that I ate, right? But grammatically, a sentence like, I already ate, is intransitive because there's only one argument, the I. Right? There's no object expressed there, okay? So this is the kind of thing that I'm talking about, the difference between semantic transitivity and grammatical transitivity. Now, I also understand I was a student of Sandy Thompson's, and you know she and Paul Hopper came up with this idea of scalar transitivity. Okay, that's not the kind of transitivity I'm talking about. I believe in scalar transitivity. I believe that transitivity is the degree to which action is carried over from an active agentive participant to some kind of patient. But what we found in many different languages is that languages are sensitive to this number, right? The idea that some scenes, some concepts that people want to express require only one participant, and others require more than one. And languages tend to be sensitive to this, okay? And so we've studied languages, well, the languages, Cariban languages that we studied in Venezuela. I did some work in Yupik. These languages really have a clear distinction between transitive and intransitive, grammatical distinction. Okay? And it turns out that Kagayanen is such a language, right? It pays attention to this number issue, the sense that some clauses have one, and some clauses require more than one participant, okay? So that's what I'm gonna say about semantic versus grammatical transitivity. You've gotta understand that point in order to understand how Philippine languages work. The next point is this slightly enriched sense of what voice is. Okay, so if you've studied Indo-European languages, basically you think voice is active versus passive, right? And that's pretty much true in English. Like, you look at those examples in one, you've got different participants are in the privileged syntactic position there, okay? In English we call it the subject. But you look at the verb forms and you've basically got two, right? You've got the active form in the first example, served, right? And then you've got the passive form in all of the others, was served. Right? So you've got the active and the passive. Now, you can talk about, you know, different semantic roles or macro roles, if you want to put it that way, in that subject position, but you change something else in the clause, right? So if you look at the affectee one, for example, affectee voice, the child was served fish by me on a plate with a spoon, okay? All right, that looks pretty much like the passive, but if you take the locational voice one, the plate was served fish on, right? You've got to have that on later in the clause to tell you that that subject is the location of where this action occurred, where the fish was served, right? With instrumental, the spoon was served fish with. Okay, that's a little bit awkward in English. I don't know how many people have ever said that. This spoon was served fish with. But it's kind of logical, right? You can kind of get the idea of what that might mean. Right? You put that with preposition later in the clause, and it tells you that the privileged syntactic argument, the subject, is now the instrument. I'm talking about the instrument of serving. I'm not the patient. I'm not serving, you know, the spoon. I'm serving with the spoon. Now, the cool thing about Philippine languages is they have different verb forms, or at least Kagayanen. Okay, I'm not going to make this about all Philippine languages because they're different. But at least Kagayanen, which is a core Philippine language, has different verb forms for all of these voices. Okay, you've got the active form. Sometimes this is called actor voice. Okay, AV. You might see that abbreviation in these examples. Then you have the undergoer voice, which sometimes is called passive. Okay. Then what Carol and I, oh, Carol Pebley is the co-author of this study. She's worked with Kagayanen for over 20 years, worked and lived with the people, and knows the language very well. Affective voice is, this makes some participant in the event that is affected by that event in some not non-specific way. You know, not the patient, not the agent, but something that is affected by the event in some way makes that into the privileged syntactic argument. and that we're calling affective voice. Location or locative voice, LV, is where the location becomes the privileged syntactic argument. Instrumental voice is where the instrument becomes the privileged syntactic argument. In English, that privileged syntactic argument, by privileged syntactic argument, we mean the argument that has most of the subject properties, okay? So the one that controls reflexivization, the one that, all of those properties that Keenan and others have come up with for subjects in English type languages, the privileged syntactic argument has them. In Kagayanen, since Kagayanen is basically ergative absolutive system, it's the absolutive that's the privileged syntactic argument. Okay, so in some sense, all of these verb forms that you'll be seeing are ways of making making different macro roles, locative, undergoer, effective, into the absolutive. Okay. So here's just some basic facts of Kagayanen. Here's the verb structure. That's not on your handout. And I just thought I'd include this so that you have some idea, you can contextualize some of the stuff we'll be seeing here. This is IV, stands for inflected verb. So a whole inflected verb consists of an obligatory transitivity mode marker, okay? And the transitivity mode affixes are given in your in a table there on your handout. And then everything between these two brackets is lexical, okay? So with some qualifications, you know, these are all derivational morphemes here. These are derivational, and everything outside of the brackets is inflectional. The only thing that's required for an inflected verb is the transitivity mode affixes and a root. And all the other stuff is optional. Okay. Now, one interesting and perplexing issue in this verb structure is this un, okay, so that the E, the orthographic E, is pronounced in this language. This un is a member of the transitivity mode paradigm. Okay, so that's something that I can't capture in a position class type diagram like this, okay, or a template like this. So I've just got them separated. This un is part of that paradigm. Okay, it's one of the categories that's expressed in this paradigm up here. And another feature of the verb structure of Kagayanen that is not represented in this template is you can have up to one and only one suffix, right? So if you have any of these other suffixes here, including the derivational suffixes, you can't get un. Or I should say, if you get un, you can't, wait, which one? Yeah. The this is an applicative marker. Okay, these are actually both applicative markers, different kinds of applicatives, and they supersede the this transitivity mode marker. So if you have a clause that you want to put in the category that's reflected by un, which is irrealis, transitive irrealis, and you want to have an applicative marker on it, you can't get the un. Okay. It just, you can't get two suffixes. You get the an, the applicative, but what happens is you get nothing before the root, okay? Because this un is part of this paradigm. And that's why in your table that you see there for the transitive irrealis inflection, you have un slash zero or zero slash un, right? Because when you've got one of these other suffixes here and zero at the beginning of the root, then you know that zero is really good. It's an allomorph of un. Isn't that clever? Living in that? And it's true.
It's absolutely true.
Okay. One and only one suffix. All right, here's some other basic facts about Kagayanen. Ergative absolutive system. Okay, so here you have an intransitive single argument clause. Okay, that woman is leaving. Okay, and this form here, so it's verb initial. This form of the noun, the S argument. I'm assuming you all know what S, A, and what do I say? O, yeah, not P, but either one. The S argument has no prenominal marker in front of it. Right, that means it's absolutive case. Then the transitive version, that woman drank that water, okay? Now the woman, the bi, has this da in front of it, and that's the ergative mark. That tells you that the woman is the actor. And the o now has no prenominal marker, so it's in the absolutive case, okay? So the o and the s are the same because neither one of them has the has any kind of prenominal marker, but the A, in this case, does have a prenominal marker, which is da. Yeah. Right? And, this is my slideshow. the next examples show the pronouns. Okay, the same ergative absolutive system in pronouns. There's a clear distinction between ergative and absolutive pronouns. So, kanan an, that's she, okay? Now, this def marker, an, sometimes you see def.m, that's not masculine, okay? That's medial distance, okay? So, there's a def near, def.n, which is near, def.m, which is medial, and def.f, which is far. And unfortunately, m, n, and f seem like masculine, feminine, and neuter, but they're not. It's near, medium, and far. Okay. we need to fix that. So here we have kanan an. That's the absolutive form of the third person singular pronoun. And here we have kanan an again, which is the absolutive form of the third person singular pronoun, functioning as the O in a transitive clause. And here we have the third person singular A, the ergative form of the third person singular pronoun. Okay? So kanan an is absolutive, or kanan is absolutive, and din is ergative. Okay? And that's true for all the persons and neuters, not just third person. But I spared you the whole paradigm. Okay, so here are the transitivity and mode markers. These are the TM ones that are required for inflected verbs. And an inflected verb is a verb that can stand by itself as an assertion in discourse. Okay? It's got everything it needs to be understood as a verb. Okay? we decided that transitivity and mode are the major parameters in this system, although there are other interesting little features to it. I'm not going to go into all of the features, but there's a big distinction between what seems to be realis and irrealis, okay, that cuts across all these categories. There's big distinctions between intransitive, okay, so you've got two kinds of intransitive here, and transitive, all right, in the dynamic range. Then we have this range or this modality part of the paradigm that is called aptative. Okay, and this is a feature that is this is a term that is used in Philippine languages, Philippine linguistics, quite a lot, and it has a variety of meanings. I think it's apt for Kagayanen. If you think of aptative, I don't know if this is true or not, but think of aptative as being related to the root happen. Happenstance, right? Aptative is like it just happened. These are situations, concepts that aren't necessarily controlled. They don't have an instigator, a controller, an actor. What I wanted to skip to here, I do want to talk about aptative because it really makes total sense, but it's a little bit challenging to present it all. The dynamic affixes and the aptative affixes have different effects depending on the semantic class of verbs to which they attach. So the dynamic affixes, the ones on the top half of that table that you had there, are the default affixes. These are the basic ones. You know, if you have a narrative text and you have an event on the storyline that is expressed by a semantically transitive verb involving motion or change, okay, or you have a semantically volitional intransitive verb, you're going to get one of these one of these dynamic affixes. Okay. Now, these verbs can also occur with aptative affixes, but then they have a different sense to them. Okay, they mean happenstance, like we didn't try to do it, it just happened. Okay, so I can meet somebody, and I can happen to meet somebody. Okay, I can make a point of going and meeting them at the Starbucks or whatever, or I can just, oh, I met them, right? And there's no intention involved there. ability, I was able to meet. So in other contexts, it has the sense of I was able to do something. The way I think about that is, although the doing it might be volitional, right? So one of the examples was able to catch the ball. Okay, so they caught the ball, they intended to do it, but the ability to do it was not volitional. Right? It's like something that they just had. They didn't try to be able to, they just tried to do it. Perfect aspect. Now this one I don't really understand very well, but sometimes it has this perfect aspect. They had done it. It refers back to some event, some situation that occurred before a situation that was being expressed in the previous clause or something like that. And also sometimes it has this passive voice reading. So that example about fish was served to the child. Okay. No agent involved at all, right? You can't put the agent in that example. It's kind of like an impersonal construction. Fish was served. The fish didn't do it on purpose. It just got served, right? okay. Now, when you have this other class, these other classes of verbs, semantic classes, so if you have semantically transitive experiential or cognition verbs, okay, so this is contrasting with the motion and change verbs, so you have to see, to hear, to understand, those kinds of verbs, or semantically non-volitional intransitive verbs, like to die, okay, to get sick, that kind of stuff, then the aptative affixes are normal. These are the ones that, if you have a story and a pig died, you know, on the main event line of the narrative, you're going to get an aptative prefix then. Okay. And you can get the dynamic affixes on those verbs, all right? But they have special effects. Okay, so you can have inchoative. If you have a situation, you know, like a semantically non-volitional intransitive verb like be read. Okay, this is a verb in Kagayanen, or to be untied, right? And you put the dynamic prefix on it, it means to come untied, to become red, to turn black, that kind of stuff. Or it can have a causative meaning. Okay, if you put the transitive, the transitivity mode affixation on it, it turns into a causative. Okay, if you have the transitive transitivity mode affixation in the dynamic domain, it becomes causative. Okay. So causative of anyway. Does that make sense? And there's lots of examples in chapter 5 of the grammar, so buy the grammar and then you'll see all of the examples. Okay. Now, I'm just going to go through some examples, and stop me if you have any questions or whatever. So here's just some basic intransitive clause, dynamic irrealis example. Okay, my child will laugh. So here's the M prefix, and this M is replaceive. Okay, so you take the root tawa, and you put the M on it, and it becomes mawa. Okay, so the T goes away. And that's just the way you say, my child will laugh. So absolutive, because there's no, I'm now indicating the absolutive that's with a zero. Okay, I'm not saying there's actually anything there. I'm just using that as a way of showing you that this is actually the absolutive here. Okay. and here's a basic intransitive, there's the pig died example. Okay, this is just a basic way of saying something died. I'm not sure if you could say gapatai. Gapatai would be the dynamic version of this, and that would imply he became dead. He came into a state of being, but I just don't think you can say that. That doesn't sound right. okay, if you put the transitive one, bapatai, on there, it would mean somebody killed a pig. So basic transitive clause, dynamic realis example. So here's dynamic. I serve the fish in a rice pot. So here we have transitive realis pa, the ergative form of the first person singular pronoun, the absolutive form of the fish. Okay. So you've got a transitive clause with ergative absolutive case frame here, so to speak. All right. And then the location is expressed in an oblique noun phrase with a locational preposition, you might say. also has this da, and this is one reason why some people have a hard time understanding Philippine language structures, is because the ta that indicates something that's not ergative also indicates the ergative, right? Remember tababay or tabay earlier, the woman? The ta is also the ergative marker. Okay. And this confuses people sometimes. But the fact is, the ergative nominal has all kinds of syntactic properties that other ta nominals don't have. Okay, so it's real clear whether you've got an oblique or an ergative, even if both of them have ta. Okay, and again, I have to read the grammar, get all of this. I'm not going to go through all of that stuff here. Okay, now let's see what we have here. Now, here we have some alternative voices. Oh, wait, okay. Basic transitive clause, dynamic irreals. Okay, so here's this ng. Okay, so ng is that transitive irrealis transitivity mode marker. It's the only one that's suffixal. All the other ones are prefixes. So notice there's no prefix on this verb, luto. There's just the suffix ng, which becomes on after an o, and o becomes u. And you have, again, a ergative case, or ergative form of the pronoun, and an absolutive form of the undergoer. And this is the beneficiary, para sa mga bisita. This MGA is pronounced manga. Okay, if you've ever looked at Philippine languages, that's kind of typical. and again, this is a oblique prepositional phrase here. Now, alternative voices. So, the way we're defining voice, or we're looking at voice, is alternative ways of aligning these semantic macro roles, like undergoer, actor, and instrument, with the grammatical relations of subject or absolutive in the case of this language. Okay, so we're looking at various possible alternative ways of constructing clauses in Kagayanen. So ga, that's the intransitive form of the verb. Now, serve, the verb to serve, describes an event, a situation, that kind of requires two participants, right? So if you're going to serve, you have to serve something, at least this notion of serve. Okay? So it's semantically a transitive concept. Okay, is that an okay statement? All right. Grammatically, in this case, it's taking the intransitive prefix. So it's grammatically intransitive. Okay? And what does it do? Well, now the first person absolutive, remember what form was it in when it was ergative? Do you remember? Ko. Ko. Yes, good. So this is a different form of the first person singular, right? This is what I'm calling the absolutive form. And now the undergoer, the fish, is marked with the non-absolutive. Now, this ta is not the ergative marker, even though it's the same form as the ergative marker. We know it's not the ergative marker for a number of reasons. For one reason, this doesn't mean the fish served me. Okay? It can't mean that. All right. Secondly, the fish has no subject properties, or no privileged, it has no status as a privileged syntactic argument. Right? It can't control reflexivization, it can't be the target of relative clause formation, a lot of features that it doesn't have that absolutives and ergatives, or some ergatives, do have. Okay? So this is not an ergative nominal, even though it has that ta in front of it. And here's the location. So this nominal has been, this undergoer is no longer the, you might say, the object of the verb. It has now been demoted. And it's kind of like these English, you know, examples, these ones that are kind of analogous, you might say, in English. The difference between he shot the deer, where the deer is an object of the verb shoot, right? And he shot at the deer, which puts deer in a different grammatical relation. It's now in a prepositional phrase, and it has different semantics, right? It kind of means he shot, may or may not have hit it. Right? And the meaning of this sentence is kind of similar to that. Okay, I am serving a or some fish in a rice pot. It's the fish is kind of less definite, less specific. It's just fish. You know, it's not any particular fish. So here are some other kinds of meaning variations that you get with this construction in Kagayanen and antipassives in general. He ate the meat versus he ate away of the meat, where you know, he ate the meat is he ate all of it, probably. Right? Whereas he ate away at it, or he ate of the meat, sometimes we say, that means he only ate part of it. She painted the wall. The wall's probably completely affected. She painted on the wall. Only part of the wall is probably affected. Okay? And this is the same kind of conceptual effect that you get with this actor voice. This is sometimes called actor voice construction in Kagayanen. When you want to downplay the reference of that O argument, or that undergoer, you might say, and put it into a different syntactic category, syntactic relation somehow, for various reasons. It's not as important, it's not as central, it's not completely affected, those kinds of meaning variations. Okay? Here we have an impersonal construction. Where you can downplay the actor. In fact, you cannot, with this construction, the fish was served, you can't express the actor, okay? If you express the actor, it sounds really odd. And notice that you get the aptative, okay? And the aptative happenstance, right? So this, although there probably was an actor, the fish didn't serve itself, right? The actor is just totally off stage. It's not being, not part of the scene at all. And the fish is not acting with volition, right? It's non-volitional, it's happenstance from the point of view of the fish. So the aptative prefix there is apt to that. It's kind of like the pig died, right? The fish served in the sense that it got served. Got died. It's hard to express in English because in English those two verbs are in different classes, right? But in Kagayanen it totally makes sense. Okay, I made my child laugh. Okay, so here we have, now some of you aren't going to believe me, but it's absolutely true. The causative marker and the transitive realis marker are the same. But when you get a causative marker on a verb, then the transitive realis marker is zero. Okay. and the way I know that is, in fact, you can put the transitive realis marker on there if you want. You can say papatawa. But Kagayanen speakers don't like that. And there's a phenomenon called haplology. Have you heard of that? Haplology? Another form of it is haplogy. What it means is reducing two identical syllables to one, right? So if you take the word haplology and you take those two lows and make it in one, you get haplogy. Okay. So this is kind of a way of remembering what haplology means. You know, people quite often, you take two, if you end up, your morphophonemics or whatever it is, gives you two syllables that are identical, there's this tendency to want to simplify it to one. And this is what happens in Kagayanen. But it's possible, you know, you can put that back in, and sometimes they have to be there, and if there's a variation, if there's alternation, like you can put it there, or you can't put it, or you are allowed not to put it there, then you get a difference in meaning in the sense that with the double pa, it has a more direct causative sense. Okay. And with only the single pa, it's less direct. But again, that's in the chapter, so you'll have to chapter to see all those examples. Okay, location voice. Okay, so here's what has been called location or locative voice constructions, and I'm just calling this a plicative, all right? There's this suffix, this derivational suffix, un, all right? I served on your plate some fish. Now notice what happens to the case frame here. I, the actor, is still in the ergative form, ko, okay? And the location now, the dish, the plate, that is being, where the fish is being served, is now absolutive. Okay, so what this un does is it takes the location and makes it into the absolutive. Okay. And the fish is now in the non-absolutive form. It's been kicked out of its syntactic position as absolutive and is now kind of an oblique. Right? The next example is what we call an affective. This is a really interesting construction, very useful in Kagayanen, where you can just grab some participant that has some, that's affected by this event in some way, and make it into an absolutive by putting the un marker on the verb. Okay, so here's an example. Beneficiary, right? I served him or her, kanin an, the fish. Okay? Maybe already, no, that was the plate. Now we have adversative, which is the same sort of idea, okay, the same construction. Some pig died, so there's the napatai, the pig died, okay. But notice what the absolutive is. The absolutive is us, okay, and it's not like the pig died us. The pig died, and we were affected by this, okay. So in some sense, what this on does in this case, which case is this? Adversative. This un says something that's not the undergoer is now the absolutive. And you understand from the context that this must be an adversative or a negative, something that's happened, that was bad that happened, relating to us. So it was our pig, or there was a pig that died, and we were affected by it because then we didn't have Christmas dinner or something. Okay. Okay. Instrumental voice. Okay, now in this case, if you have something that's obviously an instrument, you can make it into an absolutive without doing anything, without tweaking the verb at all. Okay. So here we have serve. And here we have the ergative, actor. The undergoer is the fish. This is the thing that got served. And grammatically it has the ta on it, so it's not the absolutive. What's the absolutive now is the big spoon, the serving spoon. Now, you know, just pragmatically, people know that spoons don't get served to fish, right? So you have to understand this absolutive argument as being the instrument, because it's obviously an instrument. Now here's a, okay, so that's, I think those are all the examples of, no, there's more examples of replicatives. Let's just look at some antipassive examples here. This is irrealis, antipassive irrealis. Okay, so cook, again, you have cook is a transitive, semantically transitive verb. Okay, mug, however, is a prefix that normally goes on intransitive verbs. It's grammatically intransitive. And the actor, this time, first person singular, is in the absolutive case. It's in the absolutive form. And the undergoer, the thing that gets cooked, is in this oblique or this other non-absolutive role. And the meaning is, I will cook some fish or part of the fish, or I'll cook fish for them. You know, I don't know, no particular fish, just fish. Okay, so now here's a location voice. Now, here's the one I was talking about with the in. An, applicative, is not compatible with the un transitive irrealis suffix, right? Because there's a principle, a morphological principle of Kagayanen verbs that says one, up to one and only one suffix. You can have zero or one. You cannot have two or three. Okay? There's just one suffixal position. So if you have a locative voice or an applicative construction like this that's in the transitive irrealis form, you just don't get that in. That in doesn't show up. Instead, you know it's transitive irrealis because there's no prefix. That's the only thing it could be. Okay. So that's why the transitive irrealis inflection has two allomorphs, the zero and the un, because the zero occurs whenever there's some other suffix that's taking the place of it. Okay. So I will cook in the big skillet some fish for the visitor. Okay, so here we have the ergative case actor. The location is now absolutive. Okay, so the an tells you that the absolutive nominal here, the one with the zero in front of it, is a location. Instrumental. Now, this is another interesting feature. There's another allomorph with the transitive irrealis inflection that isn't in your chart, and there's a good reason for that, but you'll have to read the book to get that. The transitive irrealis applicative, this E occurs with some verbs, but not all. Okay, so this is a lexically conditioned allomorph. Instead of getting un zero for the transitive irrealis applicative form, you just get E for the verb perito, to fry. Okay, so it's like you either get un zero or you get E, depending on the verb. And again, you have the same case frame. You have ergative case actor, absolutive case instrument. Okay. Okay, so we're talking about verb affixation and effectiveness of the absolutive MP. Let's see, she cut the wood. Let's see what's going on here. Yeah, sometimes you can get this applicative without changing the case frame. Okay? So normally the applicative on says something other than an undergoer is the absolute, either an affectee or a locative or an instrumental, right? But occasionally you get these kinds of constructions which are, you just get an applicative and there is still the same case frame. So you still have the third person singular actor, ergative form, and the tree wood as an undergoer, okay, with this in the absolutive role. So there's no difference in the case frame here, but you get no applicative there and you get an applicative here. So what's going on? Well, there's a difference in meaning, okay, whereby you take the applicative and it means it's partially affected. The undergoer is partially affected by this event, this situation. And it's almost like, you know, it's as though this, well, I don't know. It's like, you know, applicatives tell you that an argument is absolutive is a locative, right? So if you think of this as being kind of like, well, this absolutive thing is a locative, right? He cut at the wood, all right? It's still absolutive, it's a core argument, but it has a kind of semantic sense of being a location when you use the applicative marker. So it kind of is a way of downplaying or distancing the O argument, the absolute argument, from the event. So I'm getting close to the end here. this is an example, number 23 is an example from the text. So this one is without the applicative. Your outrigger tie will become untied. Okay, so it's intransitive, irrealis. The tie, the thing, the whatever it is that they tie their outriggers on with, will become untied. Okay? And when you take that same verb, bud bud, and put un, the applicative on it, it, then the absolutive is us. Right? It will become untied on us. Like we will be negatively affected by that. And here's a beneficiary. I will cook him or her some fish. Okay, so we've already seen that kind of example. Okay, so basically what I've tried to show is that Kagayanen, even though it's a core Philippine language and has this interesting, fascinating, wonderful system of voices, clause structure, and different ways of telling you what semantic macro role is the privileged syntactic argument, it still can be described in terms that are familiar to typologists, like applicative, we didn't see very many causatives, but passive, anti-passive, applicative, things like that. And I think in this particular chapter that that Carol and I have worked on for quite a while, we've now found the truth. And I hope you believe me. Thank you. Any questions?